I want to thank my partner, Dr. Bahram Abudeya, for giving me some of the slides and concepts I'm going to be sharing with you this afternoon. These are my disclosures. Endoscopic procedures have pros and cons, and to summarize my talk right at the start, the pros include the fact that endoscopic procedures are for bariatrics are minimally invasive. They are reversible, at least in most of the modalities we'll talk about today are reversible. Then they seem to be effective, at least in the short term. The cons of endoscopic therapies for obesity is that there are adverse events, and we're going to talk about those. They are expensive, and this is an issue for patients, especially since most insurance plans are not covering these procedures, so this is a self-pay situation for many patients. These are not a public health solution, obviously, to obesity. We're talking about the care of individual patients. In most of the modalities, we'll talk about induce less weight loss than bariatric surgery, and we do not have long-term safety and efficacy data as the surgeons do who can show that they save lives with bariatric surgery. We cannot say that yet about endoscopic treatments. And then I don't know if these are pros or cons, but I want to mention them. The endoscopic therapies are part of a paradigm shift in thinking about obesity. And they are part of thinking of obesity as a chronic disease. None of the therapies I'm going to show you today cure obesity. And they are part of a multimodality management involving people from different specialties and interests coming together and working with patients over time. And for endoscopists, that idea of multidisciplinary disease management may be somewhat new. You know, this is not like taking a stone out of the bile duct. One shot, you're cured. This it involves a long-term commitment to the patient, often with different modalities in play over time. Now, this obesity shift influence diagram is an attempt to show you how complex the pathophysiology of obesity is. And on this diagram, this area I've circled in red is the area that has to do with energy intake and availability. And so you can see that's only a fourth of the factors identified here, and yet that's what endoscopic and bariatric surgical interventions target. And so all these other factors having to do with dietary habits, exercise, psychological factors were really not touching with these interventions. So anything that's going to have a significant impact for the patient is going to have a rather major physiologic impact if we're focusing just on energy intake and availability. And as I've already indicated, the gold standard is bariatric surgery. I'm not going to take the time to describe these different procedures and their relative efficacies. But suffice it to say, this is the gold standard for us. But there are problems with bariatric surgery. We know that only about 1 in 100 patients who is a candidate for bariatric surgery actually has the surgery. And that means that their BMI is over 40 or that it's over 35 with significant comorbidities. So there's a huge unmet need to target and improve the course of the other 99 patients in that calculation. In addition, most of the global burden of morbidity and mortality from obesity is actually in people who are not surgical candidates. And these graphs are from a recent paper looking at the global burden. This is deaths in millions of people, obesity-related deaths worldwide related to, on the x-axis, body mass index, or BMI. And then here, not deaths, but a measure of disability. Adjusted life years, again in millions of life years here per body mass index. And if you put, I'm going to put red bars on this graph here at BMIs of 35 or 40, depending on the indication for surgery. And you can see most of the deaths are in people who don't meet that BMI cutoff, and most of the morbidity, again, in people with lesser degrees of obesity and overweight. Now, what constitutes success in endoscopic treatment for obesity? You know, this you're all familiar, I think, with the television series The Biggest Loser, and here there are remarkably motivated people. So, two twins who, after the 30 weeks of the program, had achieved a normal BMI. And is that our goal? Is that our definition of success in obesity? If so, very few of our patients are going to achieve that. Interestingly, here published last year, a follow-up study of a cohort of people who participated in the Biggest Loser competition, looking at how they did 6 years later. And this graph shows you the body weight change on the y-axis. And at 30 weeks, so that's at the end of the competition, the average weight loss in this group of people was 60 kilograms. That's 2 kilos a week. It's a remarkable achievement with lifestyle and dietary interventions only. And then 6 years later, a lot of weight regain. The median loss compared to baseline, though, is still 20 kilos down compared to where they were 6 years ago. Now, is that failure? Or is it success? I would argue that that's actually success, and that's also a remarkable achievement after 6 years. And why can I say that? Why aren't we looking for normal BMI? Well, there's benefits to even small changes in body weight, and this these graphs are from a frequently cited study that looked at diabetes prevention with various modalities. This was done in the UK. Draw your attention to this purple line here, the lifestyle group. They were randomized to lifestyle interventions, and this is their change in weight on the y-axis and years after randomization on the x-axis out to 15 years. And they lost weight in the lifestyle group down to about 7 kilos or so after a year, but then regained most of it over time. This is not much weight loss compared to placebo, but here's the 15-year follow-up. This is the cumulative incidence of diabetes over time on the y-axis. Placebo here in orange, and now lifestyle intervention here in green. And there's a significant difference between these curves out to 15 years, less diabetes, with a small change in weight. So this data is often used to say that even 5% loss of total body weight, you're impacting the comorbidities that obese people are prone to. However, for other comorbidities such as fatty liver disease, some cardiovascular factors, sleep apnea, we're probably looking more for at least 10% total body weight. So if we're going to assess the efficacy of an interventional procedure like endoscopy, we're going to say we really want to see 10% body weight, or some would say 25% loss of excess body weight. So those are the numbers I'm going to use as I go through this data. Now, the procedures I'm going to talk about, there's a multiplicity of modalities, and I'm going to focus on the ones where we have a lot of data. And the ones that, by and large, the ones that are available in the United States. So that includes aspiration therapy, the intragastric balloon, a restrictive procedure with sleeve gastroplasty, and I'll talk about a duodeno-jejunal bypass liner as well. I'm not going to talk about these other things that are not in common use or approved yet. I'm not going to talk about the pose or full sense procedures and devices, or about very novel things like this from Chris Thompson's group of using magnets to create a fistula between the proximal and distal small bowel. We just don't have enough data about some of this yet to really draw firm conclusions. So let's talk about intragastric balloons. This is the easiest endoscopic intervention to perform. There's three FDA-approved balloon technologies available in the U.S. now, and this meta-analysis looks at the percent total body weight loss with the Orbera intragastric balloon. So this is total body weight loss on the y-axis based on pretreatment BMI on the x-axis. And you can see here, if we use that cutoff of at least 10% total body weight, that the balloon induces on average more than that across multiple studies, meeting that threshold. And this study, just looking at excess body weight loss in randomized control trials of the same balloon, over 25% in meta-analysis. And this therapy, balloons also impact the comorbidities. This figure is a meta-analysis of changes in fasting blood glucose in people who have received an intragastric balloon. And the summary diamond here at the bottom, substantial and clinically significant decreases in fasting blood sugar with this therapy. Now, there are adverse events with the intragastric balloon, and in fact, they're common. And so if you look at this set here, pain, nausea, reflux symptoms, these are common in people, especially in the first 1 to 2 weeks after the balloon is put in. And you'll even see that early removal here in this meta-analysis, about 8% of people have it removed early due to intolerance. So this don't expect to put a balloons in patients and not get phone calls. This is what's going to happen. And we treat these things proactively and prophylactically. It's usually starting a proton pump inhibitor 4 to 7 days before the balloon is placed. Some groups would screen and treat for H. pylori before putting the balloon in. Anti-nausea medicine we give prophylactically for the first days after treatment, after balloon placement, excuse me. And patients need to be warned about this. It's interesting that after 1 to 2 weeks even, the gastric accommodation to this device begins and these symptoms modulate and improve. Now, this summer there was a widely publicized FDA notification warning healthcare providers about 5 reports of unanticipated deaths that had occurred related to 2 brands of intragastric balloon that are available in the United States. And I find it difficult to know exactly what this means. These are people who all died within 30 days of intragastric balloon placement, in some cases within a day or two. And the deaths were unanticipated and unexplained. And we don't know a lot about these cases, what happened. I think the biggest problem with this report is we don't know the denominator. So we know that, for instance, the Orbera balloon, about 250,000 of them have been placed worldwide. We don't know, is this 5 out of 50,000? Is it 5 out of 100,000? And when you start to think about it in those terms, it's possible that this actually is not as common or worrisome a finding as you might expect. Every death is a tragedy. We don't want to see any patients die due to an intervention, but it's not even clear these deaths were due to the intervention. So although this is concerning and I think it's worth talking about with patients, it has not dissuaded our group from placing these balloons. Now, does the balloon volume matter? This meta-analysis looks here at total body weight loss on the y-axis versus the filling volume of this of the Orbera balloon, which goes from 450 to 700 cc's. And in terms of weight loss, it doesn't seem to matter. Likelihood of early removal doesn't matter. Esophagitis, actually less likely with higher balloon volumes. And balloon migration, as you would expect, less likely with higher balloon volumes. Weight gain after balloon removal is a major issue and one where we need more data. These balloons, the current ones currently available in the US, can only be left in place for 6 months and then should be removed. And you're not really going to get significant weight loss after that anyway because of gastric accommodation. And we know from some data that out multiple years later, perhaps only 20% have maintained their weight loss. This study looked at the percent body weight loss a year after balloon removal and compared it to body weight loss in the first month after balloon placement. And they found that if you were losing 6 to 12% of your body weight in the first month after placement, you tended to maintain that body weight loss a year after balloon removal. Whereas in that first month, if not much happened with your weight, you weren't going to have made any dent in body weight at 18 months. Now, aspiration therapy, this technique involves a percutaneous gastrostomy type tube that has this extension in the stomach. It's a large caliber tube. It comes out to a skin port. And the patient, 20 to 30 minutes after meals, goes to the bathroom, attaches this device to the skin port, activates a pump, and uses a water reservoir to flush and vent gastric contents into the toilet. And the patient has to do this after every meal, 3 times a day. And so this involves a lot of active participation of the patient, involves an external appliance. But this is an effective therapy for obesity. And this pivotal US trial published earlier this year, the gray lines are patients randomized to lifestyle counseling alone who did or did not complete the entire course of the study. Intervention versus those in purple who got the aspiration tube. And this is out to 52 weeks. And you'll see here that, again, our cutoff of 10% body weight loss, This device is effective and achieves that. And notice at a year, the curve is still sloping downward. And anecdotally, patients who have this in for more than a year have continued weight loss. So it's quite effective for inducing weight loss. And its metabolic impact is there as well. Significant decreases in hemoglobin A1C related not only to baseline, but to a lifestyle group. And interestingly, despite sort of the yuck factor of this device, you know, if you look at patients who actually receive it, their quality of life scores improve compared to baseline. And that tells you something about how these patients are suffering with their condition, that this improves their quality of life. Most of the side effects of aspiration therapy are related to having a percutaneous gastrostomy, and I'm not going to go through them all, but you're familiar with them. Things like irritation at the tube site and peristomal infection and pain at the tube site. Most of these come early. Granulation tissue comes a bit later, this peak here. And serious adverse events are quite unusual. These would include, in this study of over 110 patients, one case of severe abdominal pain, one of peritonitis, one prepyloric ulcer, and one tube malfunction requiring replacement. Endoscopic sleeve gastroplasty is a technique that uses a suturing device placed on the tip of the endoscope to create sutures in a triangular fashion in the stomach, cinching up the greater curve and creating a sleeve-like configuration to the stomach. And we have data now. This is not randomized or controlled. This is experience, but we have data from two series. This shows percent total body weight loss on the y-axis and months after procedure on the x-axis. The black line is from Dr. Shariah's study, and she's sitting right here on the podium today, and shows weight loss over time out to 2 years now. And the red stars are from Dr. Lopez Nava's multi-center study showing at 6 and 24 months almost identical amounts of weight loss. And here's our line of 10% total body weight loss. You can see this markedly surpasses that. We're at about 20% body weight, total body weight loss at 2 years. Now we're starting to get into the realm of body weight loss we see with some bariatric surgical interventions. And so this again is from Reem's study, and shows that procedure duration time is significant, and she found that after the first 35 cases, the time shortened, but still over an hour to do this in most cases. And indeed, the efficacy of the procedure was also related to the number of cases, with more substantial weight loss being more likely after 35 cases. Metabolic impact, a significant decrease in hemoglobin A1C, also systolic blood pressure, and ALT in this study. And there are periprocedural adverse events here as well. Nausea, pain are common after this is done, and a minority of patients need to spend the night in the hospital because of these symptoms after this procedure. They're on a liquid diet at first with only gradual reintroduction of solids, much like after bariatric surgery. Severe complications such as perigastric collection, perigastric hemorrhage, pulmonary embolus, pneumothorax can occur are uncommon. And the duodeno-jejunal bypass liner I'm going to say a word about. This is a device with a cage in the duodenal bulb and a long Teflon or cellophane sleeve. And the idea is to bypass the duodenum. This is not as effective for weight loss, here resulting in less than the goal we would have. But it's has a unique efficacy for decreasing the hemoglobin A1C. Here at a year or 52 weeks, 1.5 point drop in the hemoglobin A1C in meta-analysis. This has similar significant adverse effects of pain, nausea, vomiting, leading to early removal in 18% in this meta-analysis. Other serious adverse events, less common. And there was a U.S. multi-center trial reported last year in which the body weight loss came to only about 7% in the endobarrier group compared to sham of about 2%. Again, significant decreases in the hemoglobin A1C, but there were a lot of unanticipated number of liver abscesses, 3.5% in this study, probably related to the barbs on this anchor. And so the reason this is not available in the US, although those of you who work internationally probably have access to this. I'm showing you this because you're likely to see other iterations of this and redesigns that deal with the barb issue, and this will be part of the armamentarium. So this is my last slide, and I want to make the point that I started with, that we have a number of interventions, and if we're managing obesity as a chronic disease, endoscopic procedures fall into the spectrum, increasing efficacy but increasing risk. If the patient has to lose 10 pounds, we're going to be talking about lifestyle and dietary interventions. If they have a BMI over 40, we're going to be seriously considering surgical procedures. And then there's, in the middle ground, the large volume of patients who are in the middle ground, we may be talking about medications, maybe about an endoscopic procedure, maybe first an endoscopic procedure and then a balloon, medication to follow, and always with lifestyle interventions as the foundation. Thank you very much.